talk about a topic today called simple harmonic motion. And when you think of simple harmonic motion, all I want you to think about is something oscillating back and forth. Where have you heard the word oscillate before? Or oscillations? Who's heard the word oscillate or oscillations? Nobody? A fan, yeah. A fan that's an oscillating fan, it doesn't sit still. What does it do? The actual axle rotates. It rotates about, what, less than 180, like maybe 150 degrees? It might be broken, Victoria. That's probably trying to put it in. Yeah. So it oscillates between like 150 degrees. Oscillating just means going back and forth. All right? Now, let's take a look at this. So I've got a spring here. The minute I let go with this mass, what I'm going to see is this. I'm going to see it start to fluctuate like that, right? Until what does it do? It reaches... When it settles, it's in a state of equilibrium, okay? Right now, what's pulling down? Yeah, gravity from this hanging mass. What's pulling up? Be careful. That's if it's on the surface. What's pulling back up? It'd have to be moving in circular motion for that. If I start spinning this, maybe. Not my hand. Well, technically my hand is... Imagine my hand is fixed, though, if I did this. You know what I mean? If I do this, it still holds true. What's pulling back up on this? The spring. So, and I wanted to start with today's lesson with that because we've looked at springs so far with what? Energy. PE equals 1/2 kx squared, where k is the strength of the spring. It's rigidity. Okay? K value on this is pretty low. You can see that. It's fluctuating very easily. So the spring of force is pulling back up. So in this section, we're going to look at springs again, and we're going to look at pendulums, or pendula. And what we're going to do, though, is instead of looking at energy, we're going to look at forces. So we're still relating this to first semester material. Okay? Now, this is related to electricity and magnetism simply because it has to do with waves. The motion of this is a wave, and we'll talk about it as a wave, as a sound wave, as a light wave, what waves are. But if I keep pushing this with my hand, I can kind of propagate this to get it to keep going. But if I just stop and let it go, eventually it settles out. Okay, and it might take a while. It's taking a ton of time to settle out. It's called the dampening factor. There's no dampening on here besides the friction in the spring and some air resistance. So if you ever hit a bump on a speed bump, would you want your car to do this? Would you want it to bounce this long? What would you want it to do? You want it to go like this, right? You want it to hit and then stop. Okay? And maybe just settle out real quick like that. Or it just settles real quick. And that's called being dampened. So like a door, for example, the damper on the door is the thing that causes its motion to slow. Right? It's moving slowly, slowly, slowly. It slows down. And then it shuts. But if you were to actually see the motion of this, if you were to pull this, see how it actually resists my motion? There's a damper up there that's slowing it down. There's no damper on this spring. Friction is a natural damper, though. So when you hit a speed bump with your car, even if your shocks aren't great, eventually what are they going to do? They're going to settle out. You're not going to be like all day long, okay? So the idea of simple harmonic motion is motion without any dampening. Imagine if there was no dampening. What would happen to this? It would do this. It would just continue to do this over and over and over. And I'm providing a little bit of push with my hand right now. That's what I was doing. But without dampening, it would continue like this, and it would continue to oscillate. Okay, so we call these oscillations. Another word, vibrations, oscillations, perturbations. A perturbation is pulling something a little bit different from its equilibrium. So say this is the equilibrium stage right here, right? That's the equilibrium state. I can clearly see that because it's settled. The minute I go like this, I'm perturbing it. I'm moving a little bit. I let go, and it causes some motion. This is oscillatory motion. Moving back and forth, back and forth. This is damped oscillatory motion, though, because it's eventually going to stop back in its equilibrium state. Okay? So the terminology in this section is a little bit difficult, the vocabulary. So you need to understand these words that I'm going to be using. We're going to use what's called Hooke's law to demonstrate the parameters. And then in the third part, we're going to explain the idea between velocity, force, acceleration. All right? So let's imagine that this data table is representing what I'm holding here. So here's my spring. I'm not applying a force. What does the data tell me that the length is? 10 meters. It's not the scale we're holding here, right? Okay, so this spring is sitting at rest from first coil to last coil. Not this piece. Not including this piece. The length you're going to measure in your lab is going to be the length of the spring from here to here. Okay, between my fingers there. Okay, not the piece above or below. Does that make sense? Because that can't stretch. This is metal. This is not stretching. This is coiled metal. This is able to stretch. When this stretches, this length is never changing right here. So this is not elastic. It can't be stretched. Only from this coil to this coil can stretching actually occur. These hooks on the end are just to hang masks for science, for labs, okay? So the free length from here to here between my fingers is 10 meters. Then I apply a mass. You're going to be literally doing this in your lab, so I'm kind of demoing it for you, okay? I apply a mass, and I apply a mass that has a weight, not really, but a weight of 50 newtons. Imagine this is 50 newtons. And when I apply this here, instead of the length of this being 10, I let go, and now the length of this is 14 meters. Okay, imagine. Then, after, that's 50 newtons of force. I apply another 50 newtons of force. And now, instead of being 14, now it's at 18 meters in length. And then finally, I apply another 50, making this 150 newtons. It's really, by the way, 150 grams. And it's now a length of 22 meters, or actually probably 22 centimeters. These are probably pretty spot on for centimeters and grams. But anyway, to keep the idea of force, what is the correlation that exists? What is the correlation that exists? Look at the data. Chen? So they are definitely directly related. As force increases, stretch increases. So we can start with that. Force is proportional to displacement. That little symbol in the middle means proportional to, or directly related to. Okay, force in the spring is directly related to displacement. Now remember, the force we're measuring in this is the applied force hanging down. Okay, applied force. Now, can anybody be more specific than that? Kat? Exactly right. Well, can you make any more from that? So this is a change of 50, right? Well, you kind of said it, actually, so I shouldn't say, can you make any more? But what can you say about the other changes, Kat?
Oh, they're, is it like the same? So it's like,
when the change doesn't change, what do you know about the function? It's a what kind? It's got a constant change, sure. It's got a constant change. What kind of a function would this be? Think to your math classes. What is it?
Linear.
It's clearly linear, okay? The idea that as one goes up, the other goes up by the same amount. Remember, when the change doesn't change, it's linear. The change is 50 for 4, 50 for 4, 50 for 4 each time, right? 50 newtons changes by 4 meters every time. So the change isn't changing, meaning there's a constant slope. If there's a constant slope, the function must be linear. It must be linear. Well, here's how we know that it's linear.
Take a thought, or take a minute and think back to K, the K value of a spring. What were the units for K? I remember it was a fraction. What was the fractional part?
Was it like newtons or kilograms or
something? Oh, newtons are right. Simpler than that. Newtons per meter. Okay, newtons per meter.
Well, take a look. Look at the data. Look at the data. What are the units of the data? The first row, the units are? Anybody?
Newtons.
Second row, the units are?
Newtons.
So, if I take the amount of force applied over the stretch, it gives me?
Four.
It gives me what?
Four.
You get 450 over 4?
Oh, no, sorry.
The 4 supplied over the stretch.
Oh.
50 over 4. You get 12 and a half. What does that represent? It represents K. The K value is really a rating, a ratio of how much force you apply over how much it is stretched by. Jot that down, please. K. K is a ratio of force applied to stretch, or amount stretched.
So what I could say is the following. K is a ratio of the force applied over the stretch. If that's true, in blue in the corner there, if that's true, what that means is this. That means that there's really a K right here. Imagine you put a K right here, and you made this an equal sign instead, and wrote an equation. If this said F equals KX, and you wanted to solve for K, how would you get rid of X? You would divide, and you'd get force over X equals K, wouldn't you? And that's what you have here. So there's really a K here, but Hooke's law, which we're going to see in a moment, we're going to define Hooke's law. Hooke's law looks at the force that's in the spring. Look at this again.
My displacement is in what direction? Up or down? From here to here is displaced down. The force that's applied is the weight of this, which is also down. So the force pulling down is what causes this to be displaced down. Which way is the spring pulling? The spring is pulling up. The spring is pulling up when the displacement is down. If the displacement was up, if I compressed the spring, I squished it together, the spring wants to push back down to expand that effort. If I were able to like really compress this and let go, it would shoot back down like that. And these aren't compressing, these are just a stretch. So the idea though is this. The applied force is always opposite the spring force. And think logically. It doesn't matter which way I hold this. I hold it this way for you, right? I'll apply a force to the right. Which way does the spring pull? To the left. I apply force to the left. The spring pulls to the right. It's always opposite the applied force. So really, we can replace this with Fs for spring, but we would need a negative there.
So what it comes to be is that Hooke's law is the following. Is
the spring force equals negative Kx.
Remember a minute ago I said you could have just written F equals Kx for the applied force. But because we're looking at the spring force, okay, the spring force, so say, again, let's look at that example we just had a minute ago, where the displacement is down, it makes that negative. Okay, K is always positive. For this to hold true, the spring force would have to be acting upward to be positive. I'm just putting signs everywhere.
If the spring force is pulling upward, that means the displacement is downward. Right? That means spring force is positive, displacement is negative. Negative, negative, times positive makes this whole set of positive equals a positive. Okay, so the negative there comes from the fact that the spring force is always a restoring force. Jot that word down, please. Okay, we're going to talk about that again. The spring force is the restoring force. What do I mean by restoring? I mean, what's going to restore it so that it goes back to equilibrium? Right? Here's equilibrium. Take a look. There it is. Right now, assuming this is the free state. I pull down on this. What caused it to go back? The spring force pulling it back up until it reaches a state of, again, equilibrium. Okay, the same thing occurs even if it's not. Here's the free length. I pull down. What pulls back up? The spring does. It pulls it back up so that it's now in equilibrium. We're not looking at fluctual rigidity this way with springs in this section. Okay, but that is another thing. Alright, does this make sense? The idea of Hooke's law? So what you should know from this is that as you stretch it more, you need more force to do that. Or as you apply more force, it will stretch further. And they are directly related to one another. It is not a coincidence that this looks like the other equation, PE equals 1 half kx squared. It's not a coincidence at all, actually. Okay, if you go on to study calculus in college, you'll actually learn why those two are related the way they are. You can come up with spring force from potential energy, or you can come up with potential energy from spring force using something called a derivative and an integral, these things in calculus. But they are related to one another.
Okay? Not to be confused, though. So this has to do with energy. Okay, that's energy right there. Whereas this is the force that the spring feels. The force that the spring feels. Two different formulas for the same general scenario. Questions so far? You need to understand this before we move on to other stuff. That's why I'm asking, are there any questions so far? Okay, let's take a look at... is in equilibrium when there's a force applied to it. So, imagine the scenario, but rotate 90 degrees. I can't, unfortunately, rotate 90 degrees here, but imagine this is B. See A, B, and C up there? Here's B right now. Okay, this is B. So this would be A. And when I let go, it shoots up here. This is C. Again, A is stretched. B, it comes back to equilibrium. C is when it starts to compress. And it goes back and forth. Stretch, compress, stretch, compress, stretch, compress. Every time, right, it changes. So what's happening is this object is oscillating past its equilibrium point. When I have fully stretched it out, the spring force acts... We'll pick up with this next class, okay? If we don't have class tomorrow, well, there's nothing you can really do for this so far. So you guys got lucky. The other class had a double. So they already started. They have to do their homework, and they already started the lab.
Oh,
I know. So hopefully I'll see you tomorrow. Maybe it'll be Wednesday. We'll see.
Or Thursday.
Or maybe Wednesday. Or tomorrow. Or tomorrow. No Spirit Week then. What are you guys going to do with Twin Day? Tomorrow's Twin Day. Alright, so the first example, we have a spring stretched from its free length of 100 centimeters to a length of 160 centimeters. If the applied force required to stretch this is 120 newtons, determine the spring constant. Alright, so determine the spring constant. So imagine you have a spring in its normal length. So let's use this example again. Let's say the normal length is 100 centimeters. This is probably closer to like 15 centimeters. But we'll say this is its normal length. And a force of 120 newtons down is required to stretch it so that it's now 160 centimeters. So if I were to draw a quick diagram of this, I would think about the initial state it was in. The spring hanging freely. Okay, that's the length. And then, suddenly, the spring has been stretched due to a force pulling down, and that force is 120 newtons. I know that the original length of the spring was 100 centimeters. And I know that the stretched length is 160 centimeters. But that's what's given in this problem. How can I approach this? How can I determine the K value or the spring constant in this scenario? Think back to Hooke's law yesterday. How do you think back to Hooke's law? How would I approach this? What would I do to solve? Give me one piece. Yes, we start with this formula. Very good. The force in the spring is equal to the opposite of the product of K and X. Now, what is the force in the spring in this problem? 120. Now, are you going to call X down or up as positive or negative, or is this going to be a negative or a positive? We have to look at our directional. So if we're going to call the force in the spring 120, right? You said the force in the spring is 120, which would mean that this is a negative 120 down here. Because that's the pull down, and the spring pulls up, right? So we'll consider down negative then in this problem. It doesn't matter. Either way, it's fine. If you call down negative, you have to just be consistent. Some of you called down positive on the midterm, but that was okay, as long as you called it positive for all parameters. But you can't call like velocity down positive and then acceleration down negative. It doesn't make sense. So if this force downward is negative 120, then the spring force pulling back up is, as Victoria mentioned, positive 120. Okay, so the applied force is negative 120. You pull down with negative 120. So one of our givens is that the spring force is going to be positive 120. What else is given?
What else is given? What's my stretch here? What's my stretch? You got it. Somebody else. I appreciate it. Mars. 60 centimeters. Now, Mars, which way is it stretching? Down or up? And we call that A, right? So
what are we going to do? Good. So up is positive. So in this case, since we're looking at the stretch and it stretched down, we're going to say negative 60 centimeters. Now, at this point in time, I could actually solve, but my K value would come out to be in newtons per centimeter. We traditionally in this K is newtons per meter, so we should probably just translate this into meters. Okay? What's 60 centimeters? God bless you, given in meters. Six. Good. And it's negative, so negative 0.6 meters. Okay? At this point in time, go ahead and solve for K. K is really Fs over negative X. By the way, I want to make sure that we're all clear about this, because sometimes math can get a little, you know, confusing. The negative is in front of the K here. But I don't want negative K as an answer. I want to know what K is. So I not only have to divide by x, but I divide by negative x to get k by itself.
So okay? It's really negative k times negative x.
If it was negative k times a negative x, it'd be a negative negative, which would be a positive. In this case, yes, that's what we have. So we have negative 0.6 in the bottom. Negative negative makes that a positive. The spring force was a positive. Positive over positive gives me a positive.
So we should always express our range.
Your K value should always be a positive.
Yeah.
X can be negative though, so maybe there'll be a problem where it says find the stretch.
Right.
And then you get a negative answer, or the force maybe could be negative.
Right.
But if this force is negative, in this case, the spring force is positive.
Since X is negative, would equal to positive, because it's negative.
Jay just asked that question. Yeah,
oh, sorry.
I know you were waiting to ask a question, but he asked the exact same question. Yes. Negative, negative, yes. Sure.
So we're only making the force positive because we can opposite the K? I mean, the X?
Well, in the end, at the end of the day, the force of the spring and the X just have the opposite signs.
So it doesn't matter.
If you called down, if you said the stretch was 60 centimeters down, and you called that positive, then the spring force up would be a negative force, as long as they're opposites.
So then like, what if you're solving for a force?
Well, then you have to look at the solution, you have to look at the problem. It depends on the scenario. Yeah. In this case, since you're looking for K, all you need to know is these are opposites. But yeah, if you were looking for the force, and you would look at the diagram, see which way X is stretched, and determine which way the force pulls.
So we get 120 over negative 0.6. Should be like 200 or 2,000? 200? I know it's going to be 2 with something because 12 over 6 is 2. All right, 200 newtons per meter. Let's look at a quick example of what Victoria just asked. That's a good question. So if you're not looking for the spring constant, but you're looking for, say, the spring force, all right, so let's look at a scenario of that. Let's say we've got, over here on the right, we've got an object, and it's attached to a wall with a spring. And it's stretched so that it is stretched to the right. So now the spring looks like this. Okay? So the original is in red, and in blue is the stretched length. Now, in this problem, your delta x, I don't care what the number is delta x positive or is delta x negative? The change in length of the spring. I knew you said it, so you said it. Why positive? Yeah, look at the spring originally. The spring is here. It's pulled out to here. So it's indeed positive what you said, okay? Because it goes to the right. Now, if the spring is being pulled this way, which way does it want to pull you? Back that way, right? So in this case, wouldn't we just said X would be positive? right? X is positive. Well, K is always positive. And if I look at Hooke's law, if I look at Hooke's law and I see this, it makes sense now. Because look, I'm going to have a negative times positive, which would give me a negative spring force. Why is it a negative spring force again in this case?
Good.
The object is this way, it wants to pull back, or the spring pulls back this way. Again, you're stretched to the right, the spring pulls to the left. So if X is positive, the force ends up being negative.
When it's compressing, it's still going to be negative.
Well, think about it. If it's compressing, then the force, yeah, the force is negative.
But
or not the force is negative.
Spring,
the
spring wants to go out still.
Let me remember your start. When you're compressing, the displacement, X, is negative. Because by compressing, you're pushing it that way, right? So then the force would be positive in that case. Because you'd have a negative, negative, and you'd get a positive force. Again, the formula for Hooke's law, it's important to write down that you're looking at the spring force, not the applied force. Again, Fs is the spring force, not the applied force. A lot of students confuse it with applied force because problems will tell you this. An object is pulled with a force of 5 newtons to the right and is attached to a spring. That's the pull, 5 newtons. So the spring force would be a negative 5 newtons. So if you're given the amount of force that's pulled on a spring, the spring force that it exerts is the opposite of that. Okay, it's the negative value. That's where you get this negative here in the equation.
We'll see more of these as we go through. Let's take a look at this first one. This is a little bit confusing. So I'm going to try to help you with this little simple animation that maybe will help a little bit. All right, so assume that this is at rest, which it pretty much is, okay, in a state of equilibrium. This right here, all right, is before anything has happened. Now, what happens is this. Take this and turn it this way, please. Okay, imagine what I'm doing, but just rotate it 90 degrees. So if you want to take this image and either rotate it that way, it might make it a little bit easier for you. So here's what I do. Here's the equilibrium state. I pull down on this with a force. This is state A. Look at the board, look at state A. See how F says F max? This is the maximum force being pulled.
This.
Galushin. Acceleration, which way does acceleration? If I pull it this way, acceleration wants to go back the other way. So acceleration is also to the left at a max. But right now it's not moving, so velocity is zero. So this is state A, when it's stretched. State B is when I let go, and it passes, so here's equilibrium right here. Okay, so when I let go of this, when it's stretched, it's going to go past equilibrium, it's going to compress a little bit, come back down past equilibrium again. So state B is when I let go, but imagine if you could freeze frame at equilibrium. It's going to do this, right? It's going to bounce up and down, back and forth. When it hits equilibrium, it's like right there. So imagine I let go, it's flying, it's moving up, and right now I'm freeze frame. It's still moving though. At this instant in time, it's in a state of equilibrium. If it's in a state of equilibrium, your x is zero. Right? Right now, look, right now, it's in equilibrium. There's no stretch. This is its normal stretch length under this mass, obviously. Okay? Now I pull on this, I let go. When it gets back to equilibrium, before it starts to compress and go all the way up, at this instant in time, its force is zero because it's not really stretched or compressed. Out here it's stretched, when it flies all the way back up it's compressed, and then it'll stretch again, then it'll compress again, but that instant in between it's neither stretched nor compressed, so there's no force in the spring. And there's no force in the spring when it's in equilibrium state. Now, think for a second logically. The velocity is zero. When I let go of this, what happens? It moves which way?
Up.
So it picks up velocity, gets faster, gets faster, gets faster. It hits equilibrium, and then it starts to compress the spring, which slows it down, slows it down, slows it down. Then it gets faster and faster, faster, hits equilibrium, slows down, slows down, slows down, stops. Gets faster and gets faster, hits equilibrium, slows down, stops. So what happens is at the extents, when it's fully stretched, there's no velocity, and when it hits the max at the top, when it hits right up there, at that max height, there's no velocity either. Then there's no velocity here, no velocity here. But in between, it's gaining and losing velocity. Right now, it's gaining positive velocity, right there. When I stop here, then I let go, and now it's gaining negative velocity. Then it stops, then it's gaining positive velocity, then it's gaining negative velocity. So you see this fluctuation. Think back to your skater in the skate park ramp. When it was at the top, it had no velocity, right? Then what happened at the bottom? What kind of energy was at the bottom? Kinetic. So at the top it was all potential, at the bottom it's all kinetic, potential, kinetic, potential, kinetic, etc., etc. No velocity at the top because there's no kinetic. But at the bottom there was kinetic and it was at its max velocity. So think about a pendulum. We're going to see this in the next example. A pendulum has no velocity to start. You let go of it. It picks up speed, it picks up speed, it picks up speed, it reaches its max down here. Then as it comes up here, what happens to it? It slows down, it slows down, it slows down, it stops. Picks up speed, hits a max. Slows down, slows down, slows down, stops. Until it continues to do this over and over and over again. It's analogous to what's happening here. It's pulled fully downward like this. That's like me holding the pendulum up here. And then I let go of the pendulum, it starts to pick up speed. I let go of this, it picks up speed. It picks up vertical velocity. It hits equilibrium, and then it starts to slow down until it stops at the top. While pendulum, ready? Picks up speed, picks up speed, picks up speed. Hits equilibrium at the bottom, where it eventually will settle out at the bottom. And then it slows down, and it stops at the top. Same thing as a spring, flying through equilibrium, slowing down, stopping, coming back. So what's happening here in this diagram is it's showing when the spring is completely compressed, the force is to the right. So the acceleration is to the right. And since it's all the way compressed, it stopped, for instance. There's no velocity. Then you let go of it when it's compressed, and it's going to shoot off that way. When it shoots off that way, it continues to shoot off until it hits equilibrium. At equilibrium, it's still moving to the right, but now the spring is neither stretched nor compressed, so there's no forces acting. Since it's still moving to the right, it's going to go past equilibrium. Listen, guys, it's going to go past equilibrium. It's going to get all the way out here until it gets so far, right? It passes equilibrium until it gets so far it can't go any further, it stops, and then it wants to come back again. So at this end, when it's all the way out here, when it's fully pulled out here, now the force is back to the left, and it's not moving. So there's this constant balance of motion and forces going on in these problems, and they are identically analogous to a pendulum movement. So let's see that in the next slide. Let's see how those two are. When this object is fully stretched, when this mass hanging on this spring, so this is equilibrium again, when this mass is fully stretched, that's like me taking my arm and lifting up the parabola. When I let go of the pendulum, which is parabola. When I let go of the pendulum, it hits the bottom. When that hits the bottom, right, when the pendulum hits the bottom, the mass is back in equilibrium. Then the pendulum goes through the bottom, comes all the way back up, and stops. That's when the spring is compressed. It stops. Then the pendulum starts to fall back. Well, the mass starts to shoot back to the right. Then the pendulum is at equilibrium again. In step four here. Well, the mass is back in equilibrium. In step four. And then finally, the pendulum comes back up. The spring goes to the right. So if I were to let go of this and watch this move in harmonic motion, at the same time I let go of a pendulum, you see them going back and forth. They have analogous natures to one another. It's not going to be the exact same time because they're different. Okay, but the idea is the same, that as a pendulum swings, it's like a mass on a spring oscillating up and down is the same thing as a pendulum going back and forth. Okay, this is going to lead us into 12.2. Okay, this will lead us into the idea of 12.2. Questions on this, though? Again, Hooke's law is the only math we did in this section. Okay, Hooke's law, F equals negative kx. This theory, though, is very important for your multiple choice and your short answer kinds of problems. All right, keep it. If you have something you're not certain of, maybe in the next section it'll help you come up with a question for it. Okay, we're going to continue with this idea. You can jot this down if you'd like, also, obviously.